The following is a presentation of KGEM-TV, available on cable in Monrovia, California, and on the internet at www.kgem.tv.
Call to order the meeting of the Monrovia City Council, April 15th. Just a note, Mayor Rob Hammond suffered a medical emergency this morning. He spent most of the day in the hospital. He is home resting, but not able to attend. And those of you who would care to, please offer a prayer on his behalf. He is a highly dedicated, very motivated man, and we'd like to see him back next time in 2 weeks. So if you'll excuse me in advance for not being him, I really appreciate that. And we will open the meeting in honor of a brand new Monrovian. Julia Seton Hoffman was born on February 22nd to the parents of Vince and Emily Hoffman. So welcome to our city, Julia. The invocation tonight will be done by Pastor Dorothy Scott, and Councilmember Marianne Lutz will do the Pledge of Allegiance. Please stand.
Thank you. Let's bow our heads. To the God who is the creator and sustainer of all life, we thank you this evening for your wisdom. We ask you to lead this council as they lead us in this great city. We thank you for giving them insight. We thank you for healing and touching the body of the mayor. We invoke your blessings that we would have peace and prosperity as we go forth in this city. In your son's name, amen.
Amen.
Please join me in pledging your allegiance to this great flag.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. We have a roll call, please.
Councilmembers Adams.
Here.
Garcia.
Here.
Lutz.
Present.
Mayor Pro Tem Kirby.
Here.
Mayor Hammond is excused.
First up tonight, we have the introduction of newly hired firefighter and of paramedic Greg Dollenbach and newly promoted engineer Tino Bucola. And giving the report is Italian Steve Scott Haverly.
Good evening, Mayor Pro Tem Kirby and council members. It is my privilege tonight to introduce two of our firefighters. First is fire engineer Tino Bucola. He has been with our organization since 2000. He went to paramedic school in 2001. He just recently participated in a very comprehensive promotional exam where he scored exceptionally well, resulting in his promotion to fire engineer. Tonight, Tino is joined by his brother Alex, his parents, and his children Carly, Nico, and Jacob. I'm very proud of Tino. He's worked very hard to become a fire engineer. He's worked on this for a few years, and he's going to be a great complement to our organization and to our staff. So with that, I'd like to introduce engineer Tino Bucola. Also tonight, it's my privilege to introduce firefighter paramedic Greg Dollenbach. Greg came to us as a fire cadet in 2007. Right away, we noticed his intelligence. We noticed that he has a very strong, positive, upbeat personality that would be a perfect complement to our department. In March of this year, he was hired full-time as a firefighter paramedic. He has a bachelor's degree in public administration, and he's also a state-licensed paramedic. Greg has been married for 14 years to his wife, Shelby, who's here tonight, along with his children, his two boys, Noah and Matt, and his mother's also here as well. And with that, it's my great pleasure to introduce to you firefighter paramedic Greg Dollenbach.
Well, first of all, Greg, thank you for being here, and thank your families for coming for this. It means a lot to us to see your family support here. We do consider ourselves very much like a family in this city, and if there's anything that we can do to answer any of your questions, or just feel free to ask any of us here, and we pride ourselves in providing the highest level of customer service humanly possible in a municipality, and in many ways we do that. there's always room for improvement. We were working on it every day. We look forward to having you serve in that capacity as well. So thank you very much. Thanks, Scott.
Thank you.
Next up, we have recognition of the sponsors for a great event. Boy, that was a great event. I was out there at the egg hunt and just thousands of children, and what a great event. So we're going to have Community Services Chairman Gloria Crutchington thank our sponsors tonight.
Good evening, Mayor Pro Tem Kirby and council members. It is an honor and a pleasure to present to you our sponsors for your recognition tonight for the 2008 Spring Egg Hunt and Healthy Kids Day event. The event was held last Saturday, March 22nd, from 10 a.m. to 12 p.m. This is the first year that Community Services and the YMCA have offered these two successful programs jointly, and it was an outstanding success and a beautiful day. Approximately 2,500 kids aged 1 to 16 years old enjoyed egg hunts, crafts, carnival games, bunny photos, a toddler area, a teen area, concessions, a dunk tank, inflatable slides, and many wellness activities. The Spring Egg Hunt and Healthy Kids Day would not have been possible, and I want to underline that, not have been possible without the generous donations of this year's sponsors. We have a couple of them here today, and I would like you to please come up and join me when I call your name. Diane Balsamo from Countrywide Home Loans. From representing Post Alarm Systems, Gina Post. In addition, our other sponsors were Jody Brenneman from Dixon Podley Realtors, Sierra Auto Cars, Kim's Happy Keto Karate, and the Monrovia Police Officers Association. If the council members wouldn't mind joining me down here for a photo with our sponsors that are here.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you all very much.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
In addition to this year's main sponsors, there were also activity sponsors I'd like to acknowledge: Foothill Towing, Sam's Club, Century 21, Adams and Barnes, the Monrovia Youth Baseball League, the Monrovia Rotary Club, the Bonholzer family, Sign Power, and Bowdoin Development. And again, thank you so much to this year's sponsors. Without you, we wouldn't be able to do this wonderful event. So thank you.
Thank you. And thanks to the Community Services Division and the Commission. They do a fantastic job. It's just a great, great event. It's one of the things that I believe adds immensely to the quality of life in this city. It's the reason why so many people want to live here and come here for events like that. So thank you very, very much.
Thank you for coming out to the event, too.
You're welcome. Next on the agenda is our student liaison of report, Rachel Jamison. Just an email, she is excused as she is heading to the east, no doubt to check out potential college opportunities, so she will not be here tonight. The next, we have consent calendar, and we need to pull number six because, well, actually, let's see, what do we got here? I don't see it in here. I'm confused, Rachel. No, it's the
summary is correct. Just the agenda, you would actually see it on.
Okay, so we're moving the legislative report to administrative.
That's correct.
Okay, so I'll take a motion on with that.
And I need to abstain on item CC3, so I'll be voting without a vote on CC3.
So noted.
I'll move consent.
Second.
Motion and second with that accession, without objection, so ordered. Next on the agenda, we have public input. And just so the people at home know, this is a very valuable time that the council sets aside for for anyone to come to speak to the council on any item that is not listed on the agenda. By state law, this council may not take an action on an item that is not on this agenda. So sometimes you watch at home, you think, why aren't they reacting, saying, working on things? And the answer is, by state law, we're not allowed to. But we do listen, and this is the chance for anyone to say whatever's on their mind that is not on the agenda. So if you'd like to speak to us, you may fill out a blue speaker card, or you may come up in turn. Do we have any speaker cards?
Yes, I have one speaker card, Becky Shevlin, Monrovia Reads.
Good evening, Mayor Pro Tem, City Council, staff, audience, and everyone at home. My name is Becky Shevlin. I'm the president of Monrovia Reads, a local literacy group, nonprofit literacy group, and we provide many programs to our citizens right here in Monrovia, such as twice yearly we go into the classrooms in the Read Across Monrovia. I know many of you looking at you have all participated. That's a great event. And we read to children in the classrooms, and they really benefit from seeing people out in the community come and tell them how important reading is and how fun it is. We also support the Monrovia Reads and Plays literacy van that goes into the map portions of our city, bringing the library services and recreation and health services to the kids and health and wellness programs. We also support proactive tutoring, the PAT program. And we also have a minimum of 3 book distributions each year through the Foothill Unity Center, and then just at the spring egg hunt that was just honored just a second ago, we also do that. So we do that at least 3 times a year. And in order to fund all those great programs, we also have mini grant programs to mostly junior high and high school classes that maybe where the budget doesn't allow, we help them purchase books for their classes. In order to fund all those programs, we have to have fundraisers and gather your generous donations. And this Monrovia, May 5th, Cinco de Mayo, Monday, May 5th, we are having our annual Cinco de Mayo Fiesta, and it's from 5 to 7 p.m. at the Krikorian Theater. We will have a Mexican appetizer buffet, no host margaritas and beer and wine. The tickets for the event are $25, but we'll also have an opportunity drawing of $10 per ticket, and we have some really great prizes. We have a 4-course wine pairing dinner for 8, valued at $1,500, compliments of the DoubleTree Hotel here in Monrovia. And you'll have your choice of 3 different venues, either at Chef Micah's kitchen table, a poolside cabana, or a private dinner demonstration with interactive dessert. You get to make your own dessert. excuse me. There's a weekend stay for 2 at the hotel. And we also will have assorted gift baskets and lots of other little goodies. So we really encourage everyone to come. I have raffle tickets here this evening in case anyone would like to purchase one. Again, $10. RSVP, if you can please do that by April 30th to Diane Domatoff at the City Annex. Her number is area code 626-303-6600. And remember that all the proceeds, almost every single dime that we raise, goes directly to all of our programs. We've got minimal overhead, so know that every dollar that you spend or that you give to us goes to our causes. Tickets are available at the city, here at the City Hall, at the Annex, at the Chamber, Community Services, and the Library. So please come out and support us. See y'all there. And if you can't come to the event, buy a raffle ticket. And we're going to try to sell them at the Friday night street fair as well. So thank you very much.
Thank you. Do we have any more blue speaker cards?
That's all I have.
Anyone else wishing to speak to the council on any item not on the agenda?
Stephen Grawley, Monrovia, California. In the last 3 weeks, I've been talking to Sheila Spicer in the Monrovia office here. And the problem that came about was some signs from realtors that had been put on the sidewalks. And when we had this discussion a year ago, I complimented Mr. Adams that his company did not do it. Mr. Adams' company has received a letter of April 1st saying they should not do it. It's been last Sunday, the Sunday before, and the Sunday before that, and they received a letter on April 1st. I think the law in Monrovia is wrong. I think the realtors should be able to put the signs up there. And I believe because people in today's economy want to sell their house, the sign should be allowed to put there on a day like Wednesdays when open houses, Saturday and Sunday for a period of time. If they're, because it does not allow the people to get proper, able to sell their house and know people that the house is for sale. But if you're breaking the law in Monrovia, and I remember this running for mayor of the city, Mr. Hammond, our dear beloved mayor, walked over to the cigar store when I had a sign outside and he made him put it down because it broke an ordinance. I put some flyers on some cars. Sheila called me and said I would be fined if I continued to do this. And I just don't understand why, if you sit on the console up there, you're allowed to do certain things and the citizens are not allowed to do things. And another thing to bring up on Mr. Adams a couple weeks ago said that the police officers should not get their raise. And last week I came, 2 weeks ago I came up and I said I think they should. And I think Mr. Cho is not telling you all the true facts of everything. And yet, I don't think Tom is that old, but in front of his office, there's a sign, support your local police officers. I don't understand that. It's beyond me. You can't have both. You can't have one or the other. Just doesn't make sense to me. But I do think this real estate thing should be changed. And going back to our dear beloved mayor again, he's breaking the law every day by putting the amount of writing on his front of his office. There's stipulations in the charter of Monrovia. You're only allowed to have 10 to 15% to 20% of writing on your window. Now, again, as you know, my beloved belief for that man, that he's just breaks the law. Now, it's up to you people to enforce it. Mr. Kirby, that you're more pro tem, do something about it instead of sitting over there and doing nothing. Mr. Ochoa, we get a city manager report every week. Why? I have no idea. It costs the city money to have this done. I think it's a joke the way you write it. We have a city attorney over there that we pay a lot of money to. That should be investigated also. Millions of dollars are put in that man's firm's hands by improper decisions made by people who work in the city of Monrovia. Now, you want to save money for the police officers and get them money? Get rid of some of these people. Every other firm and companies are downgrading. Now, there's some great people in Monrovia, but there's some also nasty people who work in the offices in Monrovia. Scott Ochoa is one of them. If we had a vote here tonight, most of the citizens would vote to throw him out. Now you have a sweet lady Alice over here, the people give her 100%. And Mr. Kirby, now that you're pro tem tonight, why don't you do something instead of sit there and just occupy space? Mr. Garcia, since Mr. Hammond can't tell you what to do tonight, why don't you do something constructive? It's a shame that this city has to have four people up there dictated by one person. I don't think in the years that I've been in Monrovia that one person voted in the time I've been here against, on the console, against what the other four people did. Marcus Garcia, that was you. Victor, you ran Victor Franco off, and the election's coming up in about another 9 months. And as Mr. Kirby said, people, you know, listen to the thing here on the TV and all that, and I'll get involved. Anytime somebody gets up here and gets involved, or you can answer a question, that's not true. When Mr. Hammond or Mr. Adams or any of you want to defend yourself, you say it. You break the law all the time. And it's very difficult for me tonight to come up here and follow the visual pollution of Mr. Hammond's campaign manager, who sits there and defends him on every way and defeats everybody else. Now, people in Monrovia, get wise. We don't need some of these people up there. The election is coming. Get out. Get out of your seat of television. Get down here. Protect your right. And make Monrovia the city that it should be, not just for a few people. And it's very difficult for me to say this because one of the members on that council I like a lot. I think Tom Adams has done a great job in the period of time that he's been up there. I think Joe Garcia, you've done a good job. But the rest of you are very disappointing to me. But Mr. Adams is now retiring from the city council, he said. And his legacy should be the last couple years. Protect the citizens. Don't protect. You have three more years, Tom? Ooh, the way you're looking is not too good. Yeah, it is tough. But I think it's this time that you, instead of taking personal of yourself, take care of the city.
I just didn't want you to shoot me away too soon.
No, I'd like, you know, you're the only hope the city has that's up there, really. And you're not a good hope at all when you have, you're just not a good hope. Just not at all. But again, come on, people, get out. Get rid of these guys up here. Bring new faces on. We got a great area to live in. We have great people in here. But these guys up here, they don't protect us, they protect themselves. And the ones that don't protect themselves aren't smart enough to know what's going on, and they don't take care of it. Thank you very much.
Is there anyone else who wishes to speak to this council on any item that is not on the agenda? Please come forward.
My name is Hal Levins. I live on Crescent Drive. In spite of the previous speaker, there's a lot of nice things that happen in Monrovia. Monrovia Reads, the Egg Hunt, Monrovia Days Parade, etc., etc. Many, many good things. It's a wonderful place to live, and all of you people are doing a great job. I just want to add one more great thing that this city does, and that is they put on an annual home tour. We call it the Vintage Home Tour, and that will be on Mother's Day. In case anybody wants to know when the Mother's Day tour is on, it's on Mother's Day. So again this year, for the 26th, Joe?
27th.
There's the expert. 27th year, we will have a Vintage Home Tour. So we expect to see all of you there.
Thank you. Is there anyone else in the audience tonight that would like to speak to this council on something that is not on the agenda?
Good evening, Mayor Pro Tem, City Council, City Staff. My name is Chuck Keene, and I'm a service officer and past commander of our American Legion Post here in town. And we have an upcoming event coming in May. It's actually Saturday, May the 24th, and it's remembering our veterans and their families, past, present, and future. I have a flyer here. I'm probably going to read that to make sure I don't get anything wrong. It's sponsored by Supervisor Michael Antonovich over at the L.A. County Park in Arcadia there. It's going to be from 10 a.m. to 3 p.m. They're going to have a special tribute to Armed Forces, which will be held at 11:30 a.m. Bring a duplicate of your military photo to be placed on a wall of remembrance. It's going to be free admission. They're going to have free immunizations, haircuts, manicures, health screenings, and veterans can also obtain information on employment, veterans benefits, and legal assistance. And I think you guys do a great job. I appreciate it. I'm a native Monrovian. I was born and raised here. When I served overseas, there's nothing that compares to our country, our state, and our city. We do have flaws. We should make sure that we run a budget in our city that we don't spend deficits like our state and our federal government. And in particular, I've been working with Tito with regards to our veterans in our library, our new library that's being built. And Tito does an outstanding job, and I appreciate that very much. Thanks, folks.
Thank you. Is anyone else tonight that would like to speak to this council on any item that is not on the agenda? Seeing, hearing no one else, we'll close that part. And I'd like to get a clarification on real estate signs. I know this comes up about maybe once a year, once every 18 months. And can we just clarify what the law is so that everybody understands what it is? And if you could do that for me.
Surely, yes, sir. We have an ordinance that, like many of the other in the family of aesthetic ordinances, that govern maybe something that is not life or death or health and safety, that the city has the authority to implement and enforce. What we do, and what the standard past practice has been, is to allow folks to put out real estate signs on the public rights of way. However, what we saw about 2 years ago now was that more and more signs started to come out, and primarily from realtors that were not in the area, people from out of Monrovia. As you saw more and more people getting into real estate, and there was this frenzied activity, people that were not familiar with the city's enforcement of the real estate signage ordinance, and began to obstruct the public right-of-way. And so at that point, the city had sent a letter to all the realtors and tried to reach out to folks even outside of the local realtors to advise them that if you do this, if you continue to operate in this manner, then you will ruin it for everybody, and the city will indeed enforce the letter of the real estate sign ordinance. And we did that for a period of time, and the local real estate community, to their credit, self-corrected, and they made sure that they were not obstructing the public right-of-way, that they were making sure that if they weren't using private property to place their signs, at least they were not putting them in places where pedestrians were having to navigate around the signs. And that's really where we find ourselves today, where we do have and try to maintain a zero tolerance for the placement of the real estate signs is in Old Town Monrovia, where it is a pedestrian-oriented district, shopping district. People are out and about and getting around on foot, and that that makes those signs that much more of a nuisance, as well as a visual distraction from all the very nice street furniture and flowers and what have you. There have been, over the past couple of weeks, folks that put up their open house sign, you know, the ones you would buy at the store, and just put their address on them and go from there. And
probably unaware of the...
Unaware of it, because they're just private citizens that are trying to sell their home in this particular market. Excuse me. But at this point, we do have our downtown caretaker picking those signs up, reclaiming them, and when folks do call in and ask where their sign is, generally they call City Hall and we tell them they can pick it up at the yard. And that's the way that that program has been enforced. It's worked very well for years and years, but the city won't, at least I wouldn't recommend, taking that ordinance off the books, because it does give us an opportunity as a fail-safe that if people start to abuse that that privilege, that opportunity, then it gives the city the right to indeed enforce the letter of that ordinance.
And there's a liability issue, too. When you have signs on sidewalks where a lot of people are walking, you end up with people who don't see them and fall, and you stand the chance of having additional liabilities, and that's the other side of the coin, as I see it.
Yes, sir, and I think the speaker was confusing his political signs with other signs, and in running for office, candidates do sign an agreement that says that they will comport themselves in a certain manner, and we expect them to do just that, and in his case, quite frankly, he didn't. So he was dealt with in the manner prescribed in that code.
Very well. Dan, if I could add to that.
Sure.
I think part of the confusion with Mr. Grolnick is that sometimes it's difficult to tell what is private property and what is city-owned property.
Right.
There's not always a clear-cut parkway. And I know one of our signs, actually I think on two different occasions, of all places, ended up in Mr. Kemp's front yard. And I had to call Mr. Kemp and offer an apology for that. But the other thing I did want to mention that was brought up about me was voting against a raise for the police officers, and that's just not true. Matter of fact, the vote was unanimous to give them a 4.5% raise, so I think Mr. Kemp might be a little confused on that. Mr. Grolnick is possibly a little confused, because it was a unanimous vote to give them a pay raise for this current year, and we did that, I think, two or three meetings ago.
Great, you did.
Thank you.
Thank you. Moving on, we're going to convene the Monrovia Redevelopment Agency, and we'll take a roll call. I'm so sorry. I missed a public hearing. It's to open and continue. DRC 2007-135. And if I could have a motion, we'll...
So moved.
To May 6th.
Second.
Motion
a second. Any discussion? Without objection, so ordered. Continue to public hearing to May 6th. Now, the Monrovia Redevelopment Agency, and we'll take a roll call, please.
Certainly. Board members Adams.
Here.
Garcia.
Here.
Lux.
Present.
Vice Chairman Kirby.
Here.
And Chairman Hammond is excused.
Move consent.
Second.
First, we have a motion and a second. Any discussion? Without objection, so ordered. And we will move now to reports of council members. And I would like to ask Councilmember Garcia to go first.
Thank you, Mayor Pro Tem Kirby. I would just like to announce that tomorrow, I, along with my colleague, Mayor Pro Tem, will be heading to Sacramento to represent the city on behalf of the League of California Cities for Legislative Action Days. And what that set of days represents is basically about 480 cities convening on the Capitol to meet with various legislatures regarding certain bills that are coming up, as well as various items that may be of interest to them, and of very particular interest to the city of Monrovia are two applications that the city has submitted with regards to the transit-oriented development funds that were voted in by the state of California for Proposition 1C and Proposition 1B. The city of Monrovia has put in an application request for the infill housing grant and also the transit-oriented development grant application, and we will be converging tomorrow on the Capitol to meet with our legislators and to meet with the director of housing and community development in the state to basically promote our cause, and in the hopes of possibly becoming a successful recipient of that grant money. So some very important meetings to be held, and again, I hope that we're able to come back with some successful news the next time.
Very good, thank you.
Ariane?
No report this evening, thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Adams?
Yes, thank you. And I do have one thing on the agenda, and I've got a couple other items that came up that we'll take no action on, but I would like to discuss. But first, at our meeting on April 1st, Mr. Kemp, speaking for the Police Officers Association, brought up the idea, and I'll quote him, "I look at resources down here that should be outsourced." And I think that it's interesting looking at government these days. I think virtually every level of government is pretty broke. We all know the federal government is. We all know the state government is. The state is preparing to take away money from virtually every city, county, and school district in the state of California to try to backfill their budget. Read an interesting article the other day about our county court system being so far out of money that they can't at times keep the elevators working. And I know that none of us want to have Monrovia end up like that. There's things that government does extremely well, and Monrovia employees probably do better than most, but there's also things that over the years we've discovered that are best outsourced out to the public or private sector, excuse me. So I've asked for a list of things that we do currently outsource, because you have to kind of know where you came from to know where you're going, and I want to briefly go over this list of the different departments that do currently outsource in community development, complicated building plan checking, attorneys for code enforcement, the MAP and CDBG rehab program is outsourced, the technical rehabs for the CDBG and MAP programs, our transit program in the fire department, our vehicle maintenance, our ambulance service, our records management, our EMC quality improvement is all outsourced. Looking at our administrative services, the printing and mailing of utility bills, collection services, document shredding, the two-year budget printing, state mandated claims reimbursement under SB 90, our armored courier pickups are all outsourced, along with computer consulting, the email servers, security testing, firewall support, wireless radio links, facilities computer cabling is all outsourced, along with our website support and our phone support. In the city clerk's office, Martin and Chapman, obviously, for our elections, the American Legal Codifiers for our municipal code, and a multilingual outreach program for our upcoming election. In the city manager's office, marketing assistance, website assistance, community media of the foothills for our cable television, a communications support group for our cable franchise administration assistance, human resources we outsourced to Liebert, Cassidy, and Whitmore for our San Gabriel Valley Employee Relations Consortium, third-party administrator services for our workers' comp and liability, managed health care through EAP, Delta Dental, VSP, Aetna, Kaiser, and Standard provide other employee benefits. In our redevelopment agency, our general counsel is outsourced. In public works, in the administration department, large volume specialty copying and shredding. In engineering, we outsource our geotechnical engineering, traffic engineering, engineering design, subdivision map, and technical checking, and our plotter maintenance. In environmental services, we currently outsource two consultants for NPDES work, waste management, and household hazardous waste and e-waste. And under facilities, fleet maintenance, HVAC maintenance, traffic signal maintenance, building security, janitorial, and custodial work. in our parks, tree trimming, parking lot shrubbery and plant maintenance, graffiti removal in our streets, asphalt paving and repairs, street sweeping, street sign designs in our utilities department, reservoir inspections, large meter testing, automatic valve maintenance, and in our police department, report dictation services, crime scene cleanup, radio maintenance and repair. And I think what may have been left out under the police department is we currently use the Los Angeles County Sheriff's Department for some of the more detailed investigative services, murder
usually
crime
homicide
scenes.
Investigations.
Yes. Under community services, recreation classes for youth and adults, competitive swim team, summer aquatics concert in the parks, a wilderness preserve management plan, ink spots and other printing companies to do our publicity, Monrovia reads and play intake assessments through Cornerstone, and the marketing plan for rental facilities with Ewing and Beeland. And I think that Monrovia has done an outstanding job of finding things that we can outsource to try to save money. And as I said earlier, there's some things government do well, and Monrovia employees do it better than anyone I've ever seen. But I would ask if the council concurs to ask our city manager to continue to look at areas where perhaps there might be other opportunities for that. One other thing that popped up, and this also came from Mr. Kemp. He sent me an email today, and I often marvel with him that he's not always wrong, it's just his delivery needs some polish at times. But he did send me something that came off of, he said a website, and I guess it's some kind of a blog, and it's about Mr. Ochoa's home. And I thought, you know, it's always best when there's a rumor out there to just get it out front and get it taken care of. And apparently the, I've never done any blogging, but when you start to add all this up together, there seemed to apparently be some grand conspiracy about Mr. Ochoa's home. And part of it I've discovered, what Mr. Kemp sent me was a copy of a tax assessor's data sheet that shows that the county use code for Mr. Ochoa's home indicates that it's government owned. Well, when I went to the Chicago Title website and looked at the use code, it clearly says that it is single family residential. But what apparently really got people excited about this is the fact that there is a second trust deed on Mr. Ochoa's home, and it says that it came from a private individual. And I want everyone to know this is public information. This is nothing that you need to come to City Hall and fill out a Freedom of Information Act form for. This is on the county recorder's website. It's all public information. Anyone can get this at any time. What fascinated me is apparently these internet people have come up with somehow that this was some big secret. So just to clear the air, 4 years ago when we hired Mr. Ochoa, and recognizing that he is the only person that we can require live in the city of Monrovia, all of the other employees here have the right to tell us no, that they can live wherever they want to. But we felt very strongly as a council that it was appropriate for the city manager to live within the city of Monrovia. But we did find out in discussion that Mr. Ochoa was in a little bit of a bind in that he had not lived in his current residence for the 2 years that's required for your capital gains to be tax exempt. So he was going to take a pretty substantial tax hit to leave his dream home and move to Monrovia, which he was more than willing to do. The council made a decision at that time to assist him by loaning him through a second trust deed on his home some funds that are to be repaid to the city of Monrovia along with interest. We collect regular interest payments on these funds. Nothing was done secretively. As a matter of fact, this item was done in this very room with an open meeting. It was voted on by the council. And when Mr. Kemp sent me this email today, he reminded me that he told us he thought it was illegal when we did it. We were advised by our city attorney at the time that it was in fact not illegal. But this is nothing that's unique. When you hire executives, this happens periodically. It was something that the council did, recognizing that it cost us no money, and in fact, we are making money off of Mr. Ochoa through this loan in the interest collection that we have on this. And it was done very open and upfront in a public setting with public input and a vote right here in the public. So for all of the people who like to come up with a grand conspiracy, it doesn't exist on this one. I also read somewhere that perhaps one of us had fronted him the money, and therefore we had all this control over him, which kind of amazed me because we have absolute control over him anyways. All it takes is three of us to fire him at any given time. So I just don't understand the conspiracy mind, and that's probably a good thing. The other thing that did come up, just so we have total and complete open and honest discussion, was the fact that someone in my firm represented Mr. Ochoa when he purchased that home, and that is absolutely true. I, however, nor my firm, made one nickel in that. We did the same thing that we have done over the years when we represented the Housing 101 program. We did it for free. Not that we needed to, but some of you that pay a lot of attention down here have heard me say in the past that I don't do it because I have to, but I do it to avoid even the appearance of impropriety. Apparently, the people who came up with this grand conspiracy have never heard that, and I hope that they come more frequently and pay a little closer attention. So I hope this puts together Mr. Ochoa's housing situation. It is not owned by the city of Monrovia. He pays property taxes just like everyone else, and all you need to do is go online and you can find that out right here. So that is that. And one last thing, and again, just for information, we did request at our previous meeting that the city manager send to the Monrovia Police Officers Association a letter requesting from them a list of the tools that they feel they need to fight crime. Many of you remember the mailer we got at home saying that they did not have the tools necessary to fight crime. So we as a council wanted to know what those tools were. And I do have to give them an apology. I at times take things very literal. And to show you how my mind works, I pulled up the dictionary definition of what a tool is. And it's an implement, especially one held in the hand as a hammer, saw, or file, for performing or facilitating mechanical operations, any instrument of manual operation, the cutting or machining part of a lathe, and it goes on and on and on. Well, we did receive a response from Officer Nelson, the president of the Monrovia Police Officers Association, which I think is very valuable because it helps us kind of narrow down really where everybody's at. Very respectful letter to Mr. Ochoa from the POA. And basically what they are telling us is there are three things that they feel they don't have that are tools. And number one is a fair salary. Number two is fair medical reimbursement. And number three is fair reimbursement for education. They go into some of the more details, I guess, on how they determine what's fair. So it's good to know that they have what some of us thought were tools to complete their job, the cars and guns and bullets and things of that nature. And you'll see later in this evening's agenda, there's some other things that we are going to fund to assist them in their work. And as Mr. Grolnick said earlier, he doesn't understand why I have a sign in front of my office that says we support the police, and that's because I do. I think I gave them $500 of my own money last year. I voted for every raise that they've ever received. And there may be some that feel that I don't support them as much as they would like me to. And I understand that. I hear it from my wife. I hear it from all of my employees. I hear it from my children. These are tough times out there right now, and not everyone has as much money as they would like to have. But make no mistake about it, everybody on this city council supports the police officers as much as we feel we can without putting our community financially in danger. And that's all I have this evening. Thank you.
Thank you. A couple things that I'd like to speak about tonight. Councilmember Garcia and I will be, as he said, going to Sacramento tomorrow. I will be going representing not only Monrovia, but our whole cluster of cities at Foothill Transit. I'll be going on their behalf and on their dime, so it won't cost this city any money. And we'll be having several meetings in the morning. We'll be meeting with our bipartisan coalition of San Gabriel Valley legislators around noon, and then we have a dinner with senators and assemblymen in the evening. And it's, as Mr. Garcia said, we have submitted some applications, which, if I may say, are very strong, to receive grant money from bonds, which the state of California voted themselves to tax themselves for. And I know that Mary Ann and Joe and I were all in a meeting about a month ago or so now, where we felt very, very strong in the response we got that our application was just exactly what the bond money was entitled to do. So it has been a goal of mine, and of course all of ours, to bring some of that tax money back here to your city. It's yours. And we want to bring it back here to benefit you. And so it's a lot of hard work, but it's worth every minute of it when you see that you're successful. So we're just hoping we're successful, but I think the outlook is good right now. The last thing I want to talk about is very light. It's about bees. I know, bees, yeah, the ones that buzz. I was in the vector control meeting last Friday morning at 7 o'clock, which is their customary time to meet, and it's not as easy a place to get to at 7 a.m. on Friday morning, but it is the time they meet. And one of the discussion items was about killing bees, because about a third of the calls that the vector control gets are for bee control, bees that swarm near schools or houses or in backyards, and people have children, and of course you know there are people who are allergic to bee stings. And the easy thing to do is pollinate almost every crop that the state of California raises up and down the valley and down the San Joaquin Valley. And entomologists are very concerned about the lack of bees, because there is a disease that is filtering through the bee population. So the discussion came up, well, can we keep from killing bees? We hope that we can, because of that, because it's a huge economic impact, although the killing that we do is a very, very small percentage. But in and of itself, it's part of the problem. And so if you do have a bee problem, please call the vector control. And your answer may be, please give the bees 48 hours to move on, because they will, on normal cases. And that keeps the killing of the bees to a minimum. There will be times when that is not possible, but if you can remember, if you live up near an area where there are bees and they tend to build a hive in your backyard, and they're becoming a problem, please call. But don't spray them with water. You may be sorry. They are somewhat Africanized now. They're kind of they've been a little bit of Africanized bees in that adds to their viciousness. But if you'll just call the vector control, they will have good answers for you, and hopefully we can keep the bee killing to a minimum to try to get through this time when the bee population is at a low ebb. And so I thought that might be of help for some of you that have bees in your properties. So thank you very much. All right, we're going to move on now to administrative reports, and the first one has to do with the architectural design for the police facility's roof, air conditioning, ventilation, and heating, and to award a contract to Cornwall and Associates in the amount of $60,000. And Dan Iwata is here for the staff report. Hi, Dan.
Good evening, Mayor Pro Tem Kirby and members of City Council. Staff is requesting your consideration to award a contract to Cornwall Associates for the architectural work on a roof replacement and engineer upgrades for a heating, ventilation, and air conditioning system. The police department was constructed in 1960 and was expanded in 1993 to add the Emergency Operations Center on the east side and the detectives wing on the west. The roof has been patched repeatedly but never replaced. It presently sags in several areas and continues to leak. The HVAC system is the original air conditioning system and is antiquated and inefficient. Staff reviewed the proposals from two excellent architectural firms, and after evaluating them, believes Cornwall Associates to be the lowest qualified bidder. Mr. Cornwall has worked on city projects in the past, such as the Mary Wilcox Youth Center and the restroom at Recreation Park. The building improvements will increase the overall energy efficiency and will be in the compliance with our Monrovia Environmental Accords. This project is identified in the city's five-year plan for capital improvement projects, and funding is available in the facility's capital improvement budget. Staff is recommending an award of contract to be given to Cornwall & Associates in the amount of $60,000 for the architectural design and engineering to upgrade HVAC system at the police department. And if the council has any questions, I would be happy to answer them. And I believe even Kent Cornwall is here in the audience to support this.
Thank you. Question for Dan. Entertain a motion.
I move we continue to provide additional resources to Monrovia Police Department by awarding a contract to Cornwall Associates in the amount of $60,000 for the police facility's roof, air conditioning, ventilation, and heating architectural design.
Second.
Motion and a second. Any discussion? We have a roll call vote, please.
Council members Garcia?
Yes.
Lutz?
Yes.
Adams?
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem Kirby?
Yes. Next is AR2, the purchase of one 2008 Chrysler 300 Touring Sedan for scheduled replacement of police department administrative staff vehicle in the amount of $27,062.50 from Glendora Chrysler Jeep Dodge. And here to give the staff report is Captain Jim Hunt. Hi, Jim.
Good evening, Mayor Pro Tem Kirby and City Council members. This report before you is for the recommended purchase of the actual scheduled replacement of an administrative staff vehicle with a Chrysler 300. We consider five factors when we select a police vehicle: ergonomics, safety, performance, communications and safety equipment, and environmental factors. Recently, Chrysler 300s have become the current state-of-the-art vehicle for administrative and detective vehicles in the area. A number of police agencies are purchasing these vehicles. The Chrysler 300 with the available 3.5-liter high-output V6 engine meets all the performance criteria for police vehicles as tested by the Michigan State Police and also by the LA County Sheriffs. What we like about that particular engine is it has a mile per gallon rating that's 5 miles per hour higher than the other vehicles tested, which is a benefit to us environmentally because it's about a 25% increase in gas savings. That particular sedan, in terms of safety, has a full frame with front and rear or front and side airbags. It has the highest safety rating for the government testing. It also has a lifetime powertrain warranty, which would save the city cost and repair. This particular vehicle was put out for bid. There are no Chrysler dealers in the city of Monrovia, so we had to go outside the city for bids. We requested bids from five agencies, and four agencies sent bids in, ranging from a low of $27,062 to a high of $34,386. Glendora Chrysler Jeep Dodge came in with the lowest bid, and the police department recommends the purchase of this vehicle to replace our current administrative vehicle. If the council has any questions, I'd be happy to answer them.
Any question for Captain Hunt?
I move we approve purchase of one 2008 Chrysler 300 Touring Sedan from Glendora Chrysler Jeep Dodge in the amount of $27,062.50 from the Police Vehicle Fleet Replacement Fund.
Second.
Motion is second. Any discussion? Roll call vote, please.
Council members Garcia?
Yes.
Lutz?
Yes.
Adams?
Yes.
Yes, thank you. Our next item is the purchase of 20 X26E tasers and holsters and five additional holsters from ProForce in the amount of $17,805.77. And again, Captain Hunt is here.
Thank you. This report is a recommendation for the purchase of 20 X26E tasers with holsters and an additional five holsters. The police department is continually looking for ways to safely deal with combative suspects, and in the safest manner for both the suspects and for our officers. And there's a number of less lethal options that we have already, but tasers have become another valuable type of less lethal use of force that our officers could use for their safety and for the suspect's safety. We used to use tasers 25 years ago here. They were a lot more cumbersome. The technology just wasn't what it is today. And we had stopped using them because they just weren't as effective back then. But current technology, the tasers are very small, highly effective, and can be worn on the officer's belt. A number of the agencies around us have gone to using tasers. The beauty of these is that they're designed to overstimulate the muscular skeletal system without causing any damage or effects to the heart or vital organs, and so you can safely control a combative suspect with very little injury to the suspect. Studies have shown that tasers have reduced the use of lethal force, they've reduced officer injuries, they've reduced suspect injuries, they've reduced the use of force litigation, and reduced workers' comp claims. The pricing's based on the purchase of 20 taser units with a holster and 5 additional holsters, and the police department recommends that the council purchase these items from ProForce, who is the sole provider of tasers for law enforcement in the Monrovia area.
Any questions for Captain Hunt?
Jim, I can't remember where I was the other day, but I saw a group of officers, and I'm sure it was something like this because they had their regular service revolver and then they had a second holster, and it was almost starting to look like they had so much stuff on their belt that it's almost like they couldn't move around. Do you see any impact from that?
That was some of the concern that we had in studying these, and some of the reason we had waited in using them. The old ones were very large and cumbersome. The particular model that we're recommending is the smallest model. The new holster that they've developed clips on the belt, and it's relatively small, and so we've even seen it on a Whittier officer. Roger and I were at the memorial ceremony, and she had to have about a 26-inch waist, and she had one on the side. So they're small enough now with the technology that they can fit on the belt, and the tasers are removable, so the officers can choose whether they'd be able to use them or not.
Is that the only person you remember wearing it that day? Just joking, Joe. So you think this is a pretty valuable tool that our officers could use?
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Any more questions for Captain Hunt?
One question about the tasers. You mentioned that communities that are using the tasers, they're finding less lawsuits and other things as well?
Yes, Taser International has kept a nationwide study of all the agencies that have used these, and it's a comprehensive study on the effects with these and the benefit of them. And the study indicates that in all of those areas, tasers have benefited. It's another option that you can use that just can help provide safety for the officer and safety for the suspect.
And protect the community.
Absolutely.
And protect the community, not only from the criminal at that time, but from future lawsuits.
Yes.
So, okay, thank you.
Any other questions? Entertain a motion?
I move we approve the capital outlay of $17,805.77 from the Police Department's Expenditure Control Budget Savings Fund to purchase 20 ProForce X26E tasers with holsters and additional 5 holsters.
Second.
Motion and second. Any discussion? I'm just glad we're staying up to date, and I'm glad we're keeping up on the latest technology, because our men deserve it,
men and women.
And it keeps our community safe.
Of course.
These tools keep the community safe.
Appreciate it. Roll call vote, please.
Councilmember Lutz?
Yes.
Adams?
Yes.
Garcia?
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem Kirby?
Yes. Thank you.
Thank you.
This is AR4, which is a memorandum of understanding, amend personnel rules and regulations to provide for compensation and supplemental benefits effective fiscal year 07-08 for elected and appointed employees. Appendix D, resolution number 2008-18, to give the staff report is Teresa St. Peter, Director of Human Resources.
And Teresa, if I could, before your report, this came up, and again, there are some people that think that Cyrus Kemp is a little odd at times, but I think he at times comes up with some pretty good ideas. He just needs some polish. The thing I've always appreciated about him is that rather than spreading rumors, he calls me or emails me and asks me. And about a month ago, I got an email from Cyrus asking me about our $350 a month car allowance and our lifetime medical. And I laughed and I said, well, we don't get that. And he says, yes, you do. And I said, no, we don't. And I said, I've never gotten a car allowance from anyone. And I did the math, if this were true, and I think I would have had about $45,000 or $50,000 worth of back car allowance payments due my way. but apparently there was a little glitch in something that led some of the bloggers, I guess, to believe that we get all these things, and that's why it's here this evening. Thank you.
Good evening, Mayor Pro Tem Kirby and council members. Councilmember Adams, you're absolutely right. It was brought to our attention that the Appendix D is not really clear in terms of compensation and benefits provided for council members. So we are here tonight to update that appendix and provide that information in a clear and accurate description for anyone to see. Council members receive $400 a month. This is in accordance with Government Code Section 36516. Additionally, council members receive $30 for every Monrovia Redevelopment Agency and Monrovia Financing Authority meeting they attend. And since there's two a month, that would be an additional $60 a month. Additionally, family medical and dental coverages are made available to council members, and single coverage for vision insurance. Should a council member not take the medical coverage through the City of Monrovia, they can instead have that money diverted to a deferred compensation plan. And finally, with regard to retirement benefits, as with all employees, the city provides the employee contribution for the PERS as well as the employer paid member contribution. The monies to provide these compensation and benefits for council members has been incorporated in fiscal year budget 07-08 as in past budgets, and therefore staff is recommending that City Council adopt resolution number 2008-18, which provides this clarification.
Go ahead.
I'm sorry, Teresa, I just think we need to be extremely clear that this is not a change of anything, that all this is doing is rewriting it in a manner that is very clear and easy to read.
Absolutely.
We've not added anything, we've not subtracted anything. It's just been rewritten so that it's easier to understand.
Yes.
And there is no car allowance for council people.
There never has been a car allowance for council.
And we don't get lifetime medical.
No.
I'm
almost disappointed because, you know, when I figured out that I had about $45,000 worth of retroactive,
that's a nice ride.
Retroactive car allowance, I was thinking I could have just bought a car.
When you look at the existing MOU and you look at the appendix for elected and appointed officials, it refers back to the department manager's portion of the MOU, and just the numeration was off. At some point, the numeration changed and it didn't get carried over, and that's it. So I think Mr. Adams is the most senior member of the council. So truly, you would have been lined up for something along a very significant amount of retro check, but that, I'm sorry, sir, is just not the case.
Well, and I think if you look at the way it was written in previous to this new writing, you looked at one and it said to refer to something else, and you're going back and forth, and I can see how that can be confusing, as opposed to just, okay, forget all this back and forth stuff, here it is right now, and that's what we're going to, just plain and simple.
Teresa, and just for clarification, those benefits have been in place for how long now?
Gee, I've been here 15 years, and I believe, with the exception of the deferred compensation, which has been a new change, it's an attorney general opinion, that came into play this last year. And prior to that, the latest change was the addition of the EPMC, which came into play about 4 or 5 years ago for all employees.
But aside from that, I mean, I've been here almost 12 years, and I've never seen a change in that.
No.
The government code regulates, as you know.
That was going to be my question. How is this calculated? We don't decide.
Mm. Well, and we should also note that even if somebody read the old MOU to allow a car allowance or something like that, state law controls what you all can be compensated, and state law doesn't allow you to get a car allowance, so you've never been paid a car allowance. And if anybody had brought up the interpretation that I guess Mr. Kemp had of the whole thing, we wouldn't have paid it anyway because state law doesn't allow that allowance to be paid.
And it never has.
And it never has. Mm-hmm. So that's just the
But I do appreciate
line.
Mr. Kemp calling this to our attention. It gives us an opportunity to correct what was a simple mistake. And I honestly wish more people would do that. If you see something that you think is wrong, just come up and ask a simple question, because what you will find is more often than not you'll get a simple answer back. And City Hall is not perfect. When you look at the tens of thousands of pages of documents that are in there, there's bound to be an error occasionally, and if someone finds one of them, we can fix it. But we can't if no one tells us or if they get out and build some grand conspiracy about how we're all driving around in brand new cars. But
on that note, I move we adopt resolution 2008-18.
Second.
Motion second, any discussion? Without objection, so ordered. And let's move on to an exciting item. AR5 is the approval of the Library Park Master Plan. Award of a contract for landscape architectural services to Lawrence Moss and Associates in the amount not to exceed $128,000. I'm pleased to say that David Fike is here tonight. Good to have you back, Dave.
Thank you. I'm glad to be back. Go ahead.
Are you feeling okay, Dave?
I feel great.
You look good. You got good color back on you.
I'm feeling very, very good. All right. Good evening, Mayor Pro Tem and City Council. Tonight, we're requesting approval for the Library Park Master Plan. This is a conceptual plan of the library. With the design of the new 28,000 square foot library building, the footprint will change in the park as the previous building. There are some changes in the library park that need to be considered. The Library Construction Committee and the Community Library Service Commission have provided their input to the new library. Lawrence Moss and Associates, a landscape architect, was hired to design the primary plan showing the possible modification to Library Park and incorporating the committee and the commission's new comments. The new library will or should include the following plans: a new entrance into the park, the water feature you're looking at, the grand walkway, the entry into the library portion of it with the flags and the military seal monument, a reflected memorial area that sits back in this area, a tiered seating wall in the side, proposed amphitheater outside, and then the new playground area which sits in the back of the yard. What you're going to see tonight is just a very basic computer rendering of these features. Entering into the park, you see right here, will be a 16-foot wide cement walkway that goes between the deodar tree and the oak tree to the new fountain.
Dave, you might want to point out the location of Myrtle Avenue.
I'm sorry, thank you. This is right here, Myrtle Avenue, Lime, and up this side here will be Palm. Due to the great difference in Myrtle Avenue to the water feature, you'll take three steps down. You can see this gentleman right here. There would be ADA access from Myrtle Avenue to the water feature that will be through a composite granite pathway. The proposed water fountain is approximately 40 feet across and about 1 foot deep. It will shoot water up in the center with seating areas along the side of the fountain itself. There are several options to the water fountain inside and also the light featuring inside this that we can discuss at a further date. From the water fountain, you'll be leaving towards the new library, and there'll be another three steps down. You can see right in the side here. This will go into the grand walkway, which is approximately 25 feet across, 110 feet long, with the middle section to be a nice planter area, which is in right inside this area. The entire walkway will include a park benches along the outer side of the edge and flowering trees. We have two types of trees for your consideration to be planted along this section, the Japanese crab apple or the crepe myrtle. And there's one of each you can see on the side, both beautiful trees. The grand walkway will end at a decorative concrete oval gathering area,
Dave, can you point out the ADA access on that for the council?
Correct, right here?
The grand walkway? But from the DG, yep. Down here?
Down here?
In front of the library?
Right here?
There you go.
Yeah. The grand walkway will end at a decorative concrete area. This will be a nice gathering area, approximately, I said, about 40 by 50. It'll be bordered by a seating area in this area right here. The matching exterior will match the building. The main feature of this plaza will be a monument to our veterans, where the United States, the California, and the prisoner of war flag will be flown. Here we're showing three flags, but again, this is just a rendering. At the base of the flags will feature a plaque with the military seals from the Navy, the Army, the Air Force, the Marines, and the Coast Guard. Along with the military seal will be a special available space for appropriate language that may want to go in there, such as the Gettysburg Address, quotes from Calvin Coolidge in reference to the World War I veterans. And this will be right this location right here.
Dave, while we're on this, can I ask just a
sure.
couple of questions? This part is decomposed granite, correct?
Correct.
What is this?
This will be concrete.
Concrete, and these are pavers.
Correct.
This is decomposed granite?
Correct.
Okay. And I see
This one's concrete, yeah. This is concrete right here? Yes.
Okay, now I'm confused. Okay, so this is concrete here, and then this is decomposed granite? I'm trying to figure out, I know, it's dueling dots.
All right.
Where's our?
This section right here is gonna be the granite, the decomposed granite, and this section right here, this section here also. This
okay.
section here down is gonna be, will be concrete. This section here is concrete.
Okay.
And this will be a plaza area right inside there.
And the plaza area?
Be decorative concrete.
Decorative concrete. As opposed to the pavers that we talked about previously?
Pavers could be installed also. Again, this is just a conceptual idea what we're looking at. So if that's the council wish, that's the way we go.
Is that something that we would make a decision about this evening? Or are we looking in concept this and details such as that come later?
I think tonight's going to be concept.
At this point, we just want to get consensus about the location of the major features, materials, while important, and please let us know preferences, if there's consensus on preferences, mm-hmm. we can do all that. But the pavers to the stamped concrete, we can really work through at this point. It's really based on the feedback we've gotten from the committee and from the commission. And now certainly it's ultimately the city council's decision as to what material you would want in there, stamped concrete or pavers. What we had heard from the library foundation was that there was not a consensus to do the pavers that were commemorative, where folks could pay an amount of money and have the Lutz family or the Adams family.
Having had just had a meeting earlier this afternoon from the foundation, that is still on the table.
Yes, but it was not consensus to go either way.
No, there
but
was
we still
no,
have
but it is
time
on the
on
table.
Yeah.
And that's one reason why I was asking about the pavers, because in the past we had talked about this being pavers, which brought up a bunch of questions.
What we would end up doing with this, if the council were to proceed after Dave's discussion and council discussion, would be to proceed to design drawings and then to bid drawings. And at that point, before we go out to bid, obviously that's when we would have to make the final call, because then we need to know what it is that we're bidding out.
Okay.
And the
and
same
even then
is
you can
true
bid out two ways.
If we wanted additional benches around this fountain, that would be at that time as well?
Well, you could even tell us that. We're looking for direction and consensus now, so the next time you see this, it's pretty darn close to final.
Because I know there's been discussion about those additional
about
benches.
About seating around, yes, sir.
Yeah. Okay. And just, would it make sense to continue talking about this kind of area here, or do you want to go through the whole thing and then, if I have questions, come back?
Let me finish my, if you don't mind,
okay.
Then we'll come back to
the okay, great. Okay, thanks.
All right. Next would be a rendering of the reflective memorial area and the tier seating. Staff's considered, we tried to think about relocating the Vietnam Memorial to the Grand Walkway, but the risk was too great, and we thought we could damage it. It is marble, as you know, we just left it alone. Therefore, we decided to leave the monument where it is, this is where it's at right now today, and then create this reflective memorial area. We would also relocate the Monrovia Garden Club World War II Veterans plaque. It's in Canyon Park, bring it back down here. Remount the American Legion Post 44 World War I plaque. Put them both on separate bases and put them side by side. All right, keep doing this. Side by side to the Vietnam Memorial. Also, we have benches in this area that we've talked about.
Dave, I'm sorry to interrupt you.
I'm sorry.
We promised not to interrupt you, but I have to.
No, go ahead, it's quite all right.
In discussions with Mayor Hammond today, he really would like to consider more of a sloped area rather than a tiered area here. So people could just kind of throw their blanket out there and read a book or watch a concert that's happening, rather than having the step down. Is there any consideration of that at all, or is this where we are with this?
Well, there's a 5-foot difference between the elevation from the where we're at right here to the main grand entryway, And so because of that and the tree system and the roots we have, we're looking
trees.
To shear it off. So, but I know you could slope it down if you wish. I mean,
if you recall the slope on the on the south side of the park behind where the old library used to sit, it was like a nice gentle rolling slope. Something like that certainly could be installed at that point.
Which
I think is what he was driving at.
I think so too.
Yeah.
I know we're conceptual, but that seems like kind of a big issue. So I don't know how to handle that.
He had left me that voicemail as well, and the man never
stopped. Will you take that under consideration, though?
Oh, yes, absolutely.
Very good. I'm sorry to interrupt you again.
That's all right. It's quite all right. We had Chuck Keen and the Monrovia American Legion. Also, they approved this concept that we're looking at tonight, and also the one in front of the library. So they're buying from this whole new concept.
Dave?
Sir?
I haven't done it yet, so this is my turn. I believe over in the northeast corner of the park, right underneath one of the trees, and it's almost covered up now, is, I believe, a bronze plaque to Gold Star Mothers. And I see everyone shaking their heads. Can we get, you know, so many of those that are scattered around never get seen by anyone. Can we bring all of those in?
We definitely can.
Thank you.
We definitely can.
Thank you.
In fact, if that's direction of the council, we can go ahead and gather all of them and put them all right there if you wish. I mean,
well, the one that's over there gets covered up with leaves and no one ever sees it, and the tree has grown up to the point that you can't hardly even see it anymore, and it would just be fitting. I mean, you know, if you think, I believe it was World War I Gold Star Mothers who had that place there, and that was probably a sapling when it was planted, and now you have this huge tree, and I know we don't want to remove the trees, but if we could bring all of those over to this one place and make this a memorial spot for everyone who has served our country, I think it would be very fitting.
We definitely do that.
Thank you.
With relocation of the building, we're creating this large grassy area on the southeast portion of the park. This could be served as an outdoor amphitheater for concert or special events or even events on Myrtle Avenue. This would be Lime. Again, this would be Myrtle Avenue. And this is just a concept that we're looking at. It could be made out of concrete. There'd be no back to it, our sides. We'd have a stairway coming down the front as you enter into the park. The back portion of it would just be flush with the ground, so there'd be no reason to have any kind of railing on the back side of it. And you get more of a use for that.
Flush to the ground on the back.
I have a question about
sure.
that. So you're saying that is proposed to be an outdoor, is it going to be a natural ambient type
well,
sound,
our thoughts are to make it out of concrete. So it could be just be a natural concrete pad. We could be decorative or just something that instead of having in the back we have right now where the theater is in the back, this would be moving up front. Again, helps out with special events we have along Myrtle Avenue or any kind of concert. You saw earlier about the rolling hills we talked about. You could lay right there, you listen to the music or whatever's going to be happening in the
you can
the
install
park.
Rigging behind if you imagine Lime and Myrtle Avenue behind this stage, for lack of a better term, you could, for a concert in the park, if the concert was oriented towards the park, have the rigging behind it, and it's a space about the size of the band shell, but without the shell, just the band stand, as it were. It also would double as an opportunity to really kind of tie in events on Old Town Myrtle Avenue into the park.
Are you going to have the ability to put receptacles, or at least, you know, things that you can tie in electronics or you know, sound or what have you to?
We can definitely incorporate it, yes.
Yeah.
Because, I mean, the way I see it there, it looks acoustical.
Yeah, at this point, what you would have the opportunity to design in all the plumbing effectively for the wiring, for water, electric, everything. To be able to make that accommodate any kind of sound system, any kind of PA, any kind of rigging.
Now, is that taking the place of the
band shell?
Not the band shell,
okay.
But the there's that
the car shack?
No.
The fountain?
Oh, no, that's still there.
Are we talking, you said Lime and Myrtle. Isn't there like where the drinking fountain
is? Oh, that's still there. Yeah.
This would be in interior yeah. of the park. If you think of where the sign that says, coming soon, new library, right in that area, effectively.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
What moves is the Mark Twain bench.
Okay.
That moves over to the area just in front of the fountain, if I read the map correct, the plan correct.
It can. I mean, the only difference with Mark Twain, even as we discuss, is Mark Twain is part of that bench.
Right.
And so if it were important to the council to have a standard bench all the way along that walkway, do you leave Mark Twain where he is and get a different, you know, kind of statuary theme that would be fixed on the type of bench that you would want to see? There really is just any number of combinations to go. That's why we're really looking at major design features that will be cost items, and then we can start to mix and match some of the finer details.
And this here, the topography here, this back corner is flush with the top of this pad?
Correct.
It's pretty cool.
Getting back to that question about, is this taking the place of the other amphitheater?
No, at this point, what we are thinking...
Or the band shell.
The band shell. The band shell would be restored, but stay where it is. The band shell, it's 100 feet from the front of the band shell to the library building. And so you... I'm sorry?
We were waiting for you to finish.
Oh, I'm sorry, I thought you said something. But you have the... You could still do concerts back there, but it would be... We fear that it might be a little bit cramped. And if that were the case and we wanted to move concerts in the park to the front yard of the library park, as it were, what you would end up doing is still being able to use the band shell for a dinner theater in the park, for movies in the park, for any number of the library offerings that have live acting or children's programs, still musical activities there. So it really just gives you one more opportunity, one more venue within the park as a gathering spot for the community.
I was just going to send a little shout out to the Monrovia Rotary Club for building the band shell in the first place, for rebuilding it several years ago. Mm-hmm. And then special thanks go out to the Kiwanis Club of Monrovia for repainting it for us.
Scott, you know, the other thing about...
I'll take that back to their meeting.
Was that when you were Kiwanis president?
No, I don't think that was me. I think they did that for me.
You know, the thing, now that the band shell will be so close in proximity to a 36-foot-high building, the bounce back from the sound from that band shell echoing off the side of that building is going to be difficult to manage. I mean, Joe would know. I mean, those of us that have been involved in stuff like this, that's the first thing I thought of was, oh man, that sound's going to bounce off that building and echo back, and it does present a different acoustical problem having the bands in that band shell.
And because it's at an angle, it's a little bit more unpredictable.
Yeah, so it's worth considering when we talk about future.
This really just gives you one more venue.
Yeah, future of the concerts.
Yeah.
The new playground area would be located in the southwest portion of the park. The decorative fence would be on the backside of it, next to the street, to keep the kids from running into the street, make it a safe environment for them. The play area would include equipment for tiny tots from 2 to 5, and then from 5 to 12. And this is just a concept. We're looking at some different play equipment that's out there. There's a variety of equipment we can look at and see, but gives you an idea of what we're looking at. The city construction management firm of Bernard Services has provided the following cost estimates for the new library park master plan. As you can see, the demo and the earthwork is about $260,000. The landscaping, irrigation, and grass is about $520,000, and the concrete $145,000. The site furnishings, that'd be the benches and whatnot, $110,000. The miscellaneous masonry and stonework is about $95,000. The electrical and conduit is $200,000. What we're looking at there, as you know, we have something in the park right now. We've got a stretch cable all around. We would go ahead and incorporate that right into the design. As you mentioned earlier about that stage, that'd be a perfect place for that. Everything would be set up, be underground, all taken care of in one time. So that's $200,000.
Is there consideration of internet access?
I'm not sure. I'll ask that to...
there are wired access points on the inside, but at this point, no, there hasn't been a direction to add them to the outside.
So there wouldn't be, like, with that concrete pad, there wouldn't be a way to get internet access there?
If the council decides, yeah, we could.
It seemed to be... I don't know why you would not do it if you're going to do all that other wiring.
We could definitely run the conduit.
Or does it make sense to put the conduit on the exterior of the library building, whereby if you are using either the band shell or that, the library building is not far away? I'm thinking of like for shows and bringing up a computer with the program.
Yeah, I mean, there could easily be conduits run from either. I mean, right now there will be conduits running into the computer room, and there are additional conduits already planned to come on out at, for futures. If you wanted to have one of those run towards the back towards the band shell, one runs forward. So if you wanted to do feeds for Wi-Fi, for video, for lighting projection stage, something, that the capability is there because it's all local.
Yeah, unless the cost is prohibitive, I don't know why we wouldn't want the most flexibility we could get, because we're going to get one shot at this.
We'll price that out and see how it comes in.
Okay. Very good.
The water fountain's about $200,000, and then the landscape architect is $128,000, for a grand total of estimate of $1,658,000. And that's what it's all about right there. The funding for the design of the library master plan is through the bond proceeds. Staff recommends City Council approve the library park master plan as presented and authorize the city manager to enter into agreement with Lawrence Moss and Associates, provide the landscape architect services in amount not to exceed $128,000. Again, any questions, if you want to look back at anything, just let me know.
Any more questions of Mr. Feig?
Yes. Can we go back to the this one? Okay. If I'm reading the staff report and I heard you correctly, we've got here three steps up, or three steps down to the fountain, mm-hmm. three steps down to the great, what do we call that? The great walkway?
Grand walkway.
The grand walkway. I'm concerned about ADA access. We have access from Myrtle Avenue going here, which is three steps down, but we don't really have it here. It would require somebody with ADA to have to walk all the way around like this. Or it requires them to come from either Palm or Lime. Is it possible to, instead of having this access point here, go to the fountain, have it go to the walkway instead? Or even jump from one, have a point where it then adds down here to add more access? Because that takes most of this unavailable.
You could, but the ADA parking will be right here on Palm for this section, mm-hmm. and the same thing, you know, on Lime. So if they're going to park, they'll park, then they go right into the library if they're looking at that.
Well, we're assuming that somebody who would need the ADA access are coming from a car.
Correct.
That may not be correct. They may be coming from Myrtle Avenue.
Can I ask a question? Kind of following on Mary Ann's, and not like I'm trying to redesign this thing. But what you're saying is going, thank you. What you're saying right here, mm-hmm. these are steps, correct?
Right.
So technically, the only, if the ADA access coming from Myrtle.
Not even there, Joe.
It's right here, Joe.
There's
right
steps
here.
Right there as well. The ADA access is the decomposed granite here and over here.
Okay, let me ask you this then. Is the steps just here, or do they go around the entire circle?
The steps are just right in the, just right, oh, uh-huh.
in that straight line from
just
Myrtle
right
to
here.
The front door.
Right there.
Okay. I mean, so I agree with Mary Ann. It seems to me that whether you have something on a side or on this side somehow, as opposed to having to come all the way around.
We could do that. I mean, again, this is what this meeting's for.
Without you know, deteriorating the overall design.
Right.
We could bring that walkway
with that access then. You know, there are people that are going to want to utilize that may not be able to, you know, or may disregard it just from the logistical
impracticality of it. And we would have to go back and make sure that the grades all work, because if you've seen that the park in its current configuration, go on the website, you can see how sunk in the library building is just from the natural fall of the property. But if we were able to run an extension of that decomposed granite walkway, as you see the arms around the fountain reaching out towards Myrtle, but to have an extension of that decomposed granite walkway kind of attach itself to the outside portion of that outer ring of the fountain and ramp down onto the walkway, would that suffice?
Yeah, that would be fine.
I mean, and not to try to impose any extra work on the landscape architectural thing, but
What we didn't want to do, quite honestly, is just have a bunch of trails zigzagging across the grass area.
Understand.
Or even if you left this one the way it is and took this one and took it right to the walkway. Either way, it gives a better access to this from this part of the park.
And Scott, that can be done. We can take it from the top and bring it down to that, to the grand walkway.
I think we're all in pretty strong agreement.
You know, and again, I bring this up because without completely altering design, mm-hmm. I think what we're trying to do is look at how this is going to benefit everyone in the community. Okay, we don't want to make it to where, okay, we can go here, but we can't go here. Right.
Correct.
That's exactly.
Very good.
Exactly. And then I have a question about the this part of the grass. We've got, like, right there is that the new event stage.
Correct. Right.
What is the grade level in here?
There's the event stage right
there. Oh, there's the event stage. Yeah. What is the grade level? What is the grade level right in here? Is that, I mean, everything slopes down, so will it be sloping down away from the?
It's going to slope this way, and then it's going to slope this way.
Back out to the.
Sloping towards the library.
No, it's going to slope towards
the. And then make its way south.
To the south.
I don't think this changes too much, this area right here.
Uh huh.
This one here doesn't change. This from here is only about a foot or a 2 foot difference in elevations.
So it's pretty flat.
It's going to be
right now.
There's not a big grade.
You remember on the old, with the old library, it was relatively flat and then ramped up to the library pad.
Right.
Right. So now that would be relatively straight across that grade.
Okay. Okay.
That's and the right. Drainage comes to the southwest.
All right. Yeah. I we've got such a grade on the other side. I wanted to make sure we weren't grading there. And then I have a couple of questions about the event stage. I showed the plan, my husband, because I think it's fabulous, by the way. And he said, oh, that stage looks like a great skating ramp. And I thought, oh, that's a good point. So can we talk about that aspect of it?
Yes, absolutely. The because that's something that is a very real problem, unfortunately. From the standpoint of kids using it as skaters using it as a launching pad to launch off it, well, they're going to be landing in grass, and so I don't know if that's much of an attraction, but maybe grinding along the front of that stage.
And are there not types of concrete or pavement that they do not like to skate on? A texturing something that could be put on there that wouldn't
bumps.
The bumps do it. I mean, of course, we would want to be as aesthetically pleasing as possible.
Right.
So maybe it's some kind of stone
attractive
material
bumps.
That's uneven.
On the edges or the corners
kind of
or granite, something that would
Mm-hmm. That's something that's at the forefront, again, unfortunately, on everyone's mind, is a material that is discouraging to skaters.
Okay.
The same material that's in our the well.
Effective, yes. Yeah.
That's a good idea.
Could do that.
And we can take that back to the architect and have
him
add that feature.
Definitely, but it just kind of can't.
Same thing with the edge of the fountain.
Right.
Exactly. And overall, I think the plan is beautiful. I really do.
Any other questions for Dave?
Not a question for Dave, but perhaps Scott or Craig. And I've heard from a few people that there's a suggestion that we should forget about the library and move all this money over to the police department, and if I understand it correctly, this money is bonded indebtedness that the voters have approved to be spent specifically for their library.
For the library
project.
And
cannot be used for any other item.
That's correct.
Thank you.
All right, with no further questions, I'll entertain a motion.
Good job, Dave.
Thank you, sir.
I move we approve the Library Park Master Plan as presented with the comments that were made and authorize the city manager to enter into an agreement with Lawrence Moss and Associates to provide landscape architect services in the amount of $125,000. $128,000. Sorry.
Second.
Motion is second. Any more discussion? May we have a roll call vote, please?
Certainly. Council members Lux?
Yes.
Adams?
Yes.
Garcia?
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem Kirby?
Yes. Next up, we have another exciting item, AR6, review of the library interior design program. April Soas, Director of Community Services, will give us the staff report. Hi, April.
Good evening.
Mayor Pro Tem Kirby and council members. It's a pleasure to be before you this evening to present to you the recommendations from the Library Board on the Interior Design Program. The criteria that the board used and the architects used in the process to come up with what you're going to see this evening was that the interior should bring the park inside. The park is part of the history of the evolution of the library, and the serenity of those colors should be incorporated into the interiors. The furniture should be rich in color and have a craftsman element of style, durable to withstand heavy use for many years. The children's area should be colorful, playful, and interesting to children. Take into consideration the previous library was in place for 50 years, so the maintenance and heavy use of the furniture and flooring needs to be cost effective to maintain and stand up to heavy daily use. The interior should, wherever possible, meet LEED certification requirements. So all of those things were taken into consideration during the time of making decisions with the architects and the library board. The Library Construction Committee met on February 13th and presented a variety of options to the Library Construction Committee. At that meeting, the Construction Committee directed staff to work with the architects to present the interiors to the Library Board. So prior to the architects making a presentation to the Library Board, staff met individually with each Library Board member and presented a variety of furniture, carpeting, a whole host of things. We put together a whole notebook of all different things for them to look at, and then each board member would said what they liked and what they didn't like. Then we also took the Library Board on tours. We went to the Buena Vista Branch Library in Burbank, and just so happens a lot of the furniture that the Library Board liked is also at that library. So they were able to sit in the some of the lounge chairs. They were able to sit at some of the tables, and the Rhodes seating chairs were chairs that they had selected, so they had an opportunity to actually see them firsthand in use. We also went to the Pasadena Main Library to see the cork floor, which has been in place since 1994 there and has worn very well. So they were able to see how that looks and how that's been used. They also went to the San Marino Public Library because it's one of the newest libraries in this area, just to see some of the different amenities that were put into place in that library as well, just to give them a flavor of what the interiors are like. So all of the information was compiled and put together for the architects, and then the architects came to the March 27th board meeting and made a presentation, and the Library Board came up with some recommendations. And this evening I have David Goodell will be here to present those recommendations that the Library Board came up with to you.
Thank you, April. I'm David Goodell with Gonzalez Goodell Architects. I'm also here tonight is my partner, Armando Gonzalez, Tom Afshar, the project architect, and Gerda Buss, who has been very instrumental in helping develop the interior palette for the project. If we could look at the first image, we'll sort of walk you through a little bit the library. Here we're looking at an axonometric or a plan view of the library coming into the main entry and into the circulation area, which is the large square at the center. And we'll use these diagrams to help orient us as we begin to look at the finishes that we have selected in conjunction with the Library Board. If we could go to the next image. We have perennially had a difficulty with showing these images on PowerPoint, so we will very much rely on a supplementary set of boards that will go up that will actually show you the finished samples as we go here. But what we are looking at, and probably the television image on the left here is the closer representation, is a cork finish on the right, and the wood finish, which would be almost all of the finish of the wood circulation hall, that the walls of that hall will be in a wood that's a burled maple with a very mid-tone stain. We began with a fairly dark stain and moved it towards a lighter stain. And as we look at that here on the board, thank you. Here we're looking at the cork on the floor, the finish on the wall. This finish will actually get just a tad darker at the direction of the Library Commission. And then the paint finish, that will be primarily the finish of the wall system. And the two sketches that you see here on the board are the entry vault as you walk into the main entry of the library, and then the circulation hall as we get into the central portion of the library. Straight ahead is the circulation desk, which would be finished in a darker wood, and then to the right would be the adult collection of the library. And then what we're also seeing here, and if we could go to the next slide, are the finishes for the furniture in the adult library. And in the next image, please. And again, the preference for the Library Commission has been a wood finish on the furniture that's in a darker tone, which would be a mahogany, and a furniture collection which is derived from a craftsman design aesthetic. It is mostly wood. We're looking here at wood tables, wood chairs, again wood tables, wood chairs, and an upholstered couch and chair system that would also have arms that could be used for and would have turn-ups for computer use and that sort of thing. So a very classical furniture collection with a craftsman aesthetic that would be in a dark wood system. The carpet, actually, if we could show the carpet for the areas that are primarily, the cork would go out throughout the adult section and the circulation hall. The carpet is actually a fairly limited area, but it would occur in the community room and in the heritage room and in some of the study rooms. So this is the carpet that the Library Commission has approved. And next image, please. Again, an image in the slide of the furniture system. next image, please. And then the chairs in the community room, if we could go to the next slide. We have two options that we've considered with the Library Commission. One is a wood chair they are both stackable chairs. One of the chairs is a kind of a basically a fabric, but a very tough fabric that is on the upper portion of this picture. Another is a wood finish, and we discussed both of these with the Library Commission. It's, I think, the general consensus that the wood chair is more in keeping with the basic craftsman and traditional sense of the library. We know that the fabric woven chair was used at San Marino, and so there was some discussion about liking both of those chairs. I think it's our recommendation that the wood chair be the direction that this room go in terms of the furniture.
Did anyone sit in one of those?
Yes.
I'd just like to clarify on that. The recommendation from the board and from staff were the mesh chairs. We know that the wood chairs do meet with the look of things, but the mesh chairs, first of all, they're very, very light, and that room is going to get used a lot, have to be set up and torn down frequently, and you can stack these chairs higher. We have limited storage space, so we could probably fit a lot more chairs. The board did go to San Marino, and actually some of them actually sat in these chairs, and the mesh chairs are very, very comfortable. So from a standpoint of of flexibility and being able to store a lot of chairs, be able to set up a room quickly and easily. The preference is for the mesh chairs.
April,
what about longevity?
Yeah, wear and tear on.
As far as we can check into that, I know Monterey Park just put these chairs. Most of the libraries are now going to these mesh chairs.
That doesn't tell
so
us how long they last.
I don't know exactly, okay. But I know that is something, even in their technology centers, they're using this type of a chair. So we could find that out for you, though.
The mesh chair is indeed a very durable material. It's one of these basically hybrid materials that has an incredibly long life.
I do have a question. If I could go back to the cork flooring for just a moment. I've read a lot about the demise of the world's cork trees. Is that any kind of an issue with cork flooring? I know a lot of people are switching over to bamboo and some other products. Mm.
Well, in fact, this may be there may be a debate among the sustainable world about cork, but cork is considered it's one of the materials that is getting us LEED points because it is it's a renewable resource in terms of replanting cork, and quickly growing in terms of the tree.
Okay.
It's a very durable material compared to carpet and. Compared to bamboo, cork is a very tough material. Bamboo tends to be a material that can be dented fairly quickly and easily and may not be quite the right thing for a library.
Thank you.
David, I have a question. If you go back to the wood, one more, with regards to the actual different types of components of furniture, are these going to be customized for this particular, for the library? Are they not going to be generic style? They're actually going to be custom manufactured for this particular room?
I'm
looking at some different components here, and they're obviously things that you normally don't see as a standardized craftsman type. Piece.
Well, indeed, for reasons that we probably could talk for hours about, the craftsman chair, that is this sort of very intense vertical rhythm on the back of the chair and the wood form of the chair, it's a fairly traditional and it's a manufactured item. And so, in fact, these are not custom pieces that we're proposing for the adult part of the library. And yet they do have an enormously classical resonance in their style. In the children's library, which we'll show you shortly, in fact, we are proposing some very simple custom adaptations.
Okay. So you're saying that these are basically generic craftsman manufactured chairs?
Yeah, generic. Yes, although I would say they're a classical craftsman type. They're not a very common type in the sense that they're everywhere that you go.
Actually, the furniture vendors that we showed, or the furniture that we showed, our library building consultant Linda Demers works with furniture companies, and these are actually the pictures that I showed, and some of these pictures you see are furniture that are made specifically for libraries. That's what they're designed for, and so
they look like library.
That's what
tables and chairs.
That's what they are. It's not custom. It's furniture that is designed for libraries.
No, exactly.
But you're not going to find it at IKEA.
Well, no. And that was because I know I've seen these at Pasadena Central, and so I was trying to figure if that was the same type of design feature for that particular thing.
The design features are the same. The things that we control is the type of the wood, which we're recommending maple, which is a very hard wood, the stain for the furniture, which we're recommending the mahogany, and the tabletops. We're recommending a laminate and a darker laminate tabletop so that it prevents the marring and the marks from pens and pencils.
So next image, please. Now we go to the teen area, and this is a bit more of an experimental area. And it's an area in libraries that need to have a bit more of a retail sense, a bit more of a fun sense. And so if we look at the next image, and we'll show you, the Gerda will bring the carpet to show. The carpet that the Library Commission recommends is a fairly dynamic charcoal with stripe carpet, very colorful. And we know so far in our discussions with the Library Commission and staff that we want to have a sense of cafe tables and stools that have a bit of a high nature to them. And these are four or five options that we have for those cafe tables. We have not yet gotten together and presented these and selected them. So just to share with you, this is a direction, and it's a direction that needs further refinement. But again, if we picture this carpet in the context of the cork as a kind of alcoved area that's separated by wood bookcases and wood elements, it has its own very discrete kind of zone for the teenagers in the library.
If I could just add something, the reason I can see some question marks on your faces. One of the things is a cork floor would be going into the adult section. This carpeting would define the teen space. And that's something when we went to tour other libraries that is used very frequently, rather than putting up actual walls to make a space, they would change the carpeting or the floor texturing or put up shelving units in different areas so you create your own space. And that's really what the staff and the library board had talked about earlier on, is that's a target market that we want to get to, and so we want to create a space for them. So in the adult section, you imagine walking in there and you'll first walk onto cork, but you see this carpeted area and it's totally designed for teens. It'll have shelving that'll kind of also partition it off, but it will be their space in the library outside of the other areas.
And April, just to clarify with the carpet, they are, as we see here, squares, mm-hmm. and they are placed like that throughout the floor. But the best part about those squares is if something happens to one of them, we can pull up that square and replace that square individually rather than have to recarpet the whole area. Mm-hmm. So it's very user-friendly.
And I don't mean to steal David's presentation, but just to kind of jump forward too, there's a study room that's going to be adjacent to this teen area. So the recommendation from the library board was to use the thinner stripes in that study room area. So it kind of makes that whole corner blend together.
And as you know, this will be a LEED building in terms of its basic design components. And both this carpet and the other carpet that we showed you are both recycled carpet and contribute to the LEED rating. Next image, please. This now takes us to the children's portion of the library. And just so that we just to go back a little bit in the history of this, the central square, again, is the circulation. The areas that are on the left and right running the long line, if you will, down the center is a clerestory, that is a skylit or daylit section of the library. And then the stacks in the children's library would occur off of each side of that. So if we go to the next image, there are two options that we presented to the Library Commission. Actually, there were a great number of options that we presented, but two that kind of finally came under discussion were, they both have the same pattern and they have a little bit of a different coloration. Here we have an ochre and brown and kind of a red-orange tone. I would say a very happy carpet, and with a variety of patterns to the carpet as we come in. And this was a carpet that's very compatible to the cork and has a number of patterns that are both circular and fairly freeform in their kind of squares within squares within circles. The furniture that would go with this, and what we're looking at here on the board, are two options. The one that would go with this red toned carpet is fabrics in the magenta here, a wood tone that would be in the red tone, and then we're basically looking at the countertop for the circulation area in the red-orange at the bottom. And so a variety of furniture that would also include, incidentally, the original wood in terms of furniture and doors and that sort of thing within the children's library. So that was option one. And it was especially well-liked by staff with the concept that coming into the children's library, we might have something like a reconstruction of an original trolley that, as we pass in from the circulation area into the children's library, there could be a trolley that would contain seating, benches, books, and be a real transition into a bit of a different world. The red has had a lot of resonance with the idea of that trolley. The other option, in terms of the carpet and the finishes, the architectural firm felt had a little more continuity with the overall color pattern of the library. That is, the cork tones, the natural tones of the green main carpet, and also with the teen carpet. So this is a second option, and I think we all haven't yet quite landed, but we would certainly welcome any comments from council on these two options. And again, on the board, looking at the fabrics and the wood finish and the circulation desk finish that would occur in conjunction with this second option.
Can you get those patterns in like a household quality, or is that just commercial?
Well, this is a commercial carpet, so I'm not sure about the answer to that.
Okay, thank you.
You go.
You know, I think...
Okay, maybe I'll go.
I'll tell you what, why don't we... I don't know what you're... We'll go ahead and ask your question, but I think what we need to do is when you're finished with the presentation, I'd like to take a break so I can come and look at these things
mm-hmm.
and look at that tile and just... Before I can...
Good.
Go ahead, Marianne.
Dan, before you take your break, and I have to apologize, Glenn Owens is here this evening, and I asked him to come down for the previous presentation to talk to us about water.
Okay.
And the acoustics of water, and then I, just probably because of old age, forgot to call on him.
Well, roll that cat right here on top of it.
But maybe you could get that real quick before your break?
Yeah, we will.
And I'm sorry, Glenn. Just a couple
I'll tell you what
minutes.
We'll finish this presentation, and we'll have you speak about the water feature. And then we'll, with your permission, I'd like to take about a 5 or 10 minute break so I can check these things out and
sure.
look at them and touch them. Go ahead.
Good.
Can I ask my real quick question? Between the red and the green differences in the children's library, where did the library board stand?
The library board, here's how it went. We presented all of the options that we had. There was a general consensus that moved to the red scheme. At the end of the meeting, we were looking at the carpet for the main library and looking at the teen carpet, and I said, well, you know, in terms of continuity through the library, this palette seems to have a little more of a continuous sense to it as you move from one part of the library to the other. At that point, I think the library board saw that point. At the same time, staff came forward and said, we like the red. And the library board, I think, basically said, well, we have time and let's keep talking. And I don't think anyone landed on a let's do it this way at that stage. No, you
I
may
just
you,
clarify
yeah,
that a little
yeah.
bit. What led into the discussion for the colors for the children's area is that the library board strongly asked for a themed entrance to the children's area. And with staff a while back, we were talking about what type of a themed entrance would be possible. And at one point, we talked about a trolley. Since we see the kids see the Old Town trolley all over town, it would be cute to have something like that, that they would feel like they were actually sitting in. You might even be able to put some characters in. Well, when they start talking about that, you visualize the trolley, and its colors are red and with the green. So predominantly, the trolley is red. Doesn't mean that the carpet
necessarily has to go without or that the trolley has to be red, but that was the concept, and so that's why they were leaning towards the red and the yellow, but they both looked at both, so that's the idea.
Next image, please. And the children's story room and the big cozy. If you look at this carpet, we're looking at quite a lot of random application of pattern. I think as we get into those rooms, we might take, for instance,
the simpler, bigger pattern and apply that throughout the room, so that there'd be a little less visual activity.
And again, next image, and in such a way that we might sort of again apply a typical pattern throughout the room. And the next one, and next, and again next. So. Very briefly, we'll just share with you that if we could go to the next image, the staff areas. And the administrative areas, again, we would use the darker wood for the furniture within those areas, and the same carpet that we showed you earlier for the main areas of the adult portion of the library. And next. Actually, I think we could pretty much breeze through the remainder of these. We're looking at the Friends store again in the same carpet. And then the next image, restrooms. We're looking at basically a very simple polished concrete floor with reconstituted sustainable counters, simple white tile, and toilet partitions in a very simple metallic color. And those are on the boards, and we can ask you to come up and look at those during this break. I think on the screen they really don't make a lot of sense. So again, that constitutes the PowerPoint presentation of the interiors.
Great. No, on those materials for the restrooms, are we able to purchase unscratchable surfaces, and is that possible?
Yes.
Because we'll need to do that.
And yes.
I know that it's a constant battle, and I don't want to...
Graffiti-proof.
Well, whatever it takes, but this is the time to choose the right materials.
Yes.
So, thank you. Any other questions before we take a break? Oh, yes. Are we done with this presentation? Any questions? Well, thank you very much. At this time, we'll enjoy a little water feature information from our friend Glenn Owens.
I'm sorry, Glenn.
That's all right. Mayor Pro Tem, Mr. Kirby, and the rest of your council members, I thought it was important to come and talk to this plant. First of all, let me say that what I've seen is outstanding. I think that it's what we'd expect to come out of Monrovia. And if Mr. Grohlbeck says you guys are incompetent, you're incompetent about doing things wrong. You're competent at doing things right. Let me tell you, this thing is beautiful. But on the water feature, I'd like to, I don't know if we can go back to that. Can we go back to the water feature? That's my main concern on that. Because I had a couple of comments and maybe you could tune it up and make it a little better. Okay, my suggestions are probably twofold in the material that the water feature is made out of. I think should probably be some kind of a granite feature, because if there's an official stone in Monrovia, it's granite, and the water fountain on the corner is granite, and the first library was all granite. So I think if you did the perimeter of the water feature on granite, it would be nice. The other thing, that when you do a water feature, people say a fountain. Well, a water feature has two factors to it. It's a visual factor and acoustic factor. And I assure you that if you concentrate on that water feature, you concentrate on the acoustics, you'll have a much better and much more remembered memorial fountain than you would if you concentrate on the visual. Because, you know, I speak from experience. I've one of the few people, and maybe I've been in the mountains too long, but I've had a cabin on a stream for 45 years, and I can attest to, if the water feature is designed right, like a stream, the water will talk. I mean, I've more than one time been working out by the cabin and went around and thought somebody was talking around in front of the cabin, and it was a stream. In fact, about a half a mile above Sturgeon Falls, there's a place we call Laughing Water, and you can go up there and the water actually laughs, and it changes at different times of the year because of the water level, and every year it's different. It sings a different song because you get rocks moved around and you get log jams or leaf piles that change the acoustics of it. But I think if we can get somebody to pay attention to the acoustics, and it doesn't have to be a fountain, maybe more of a waterfall, rivulet, or something like that. And the other thing is putting benches around it. I think it would be a place where people would like to meditate and such as that. And I agree with Mayor Hammond's comment. I think that the expenditure of putting the concrete on those terraces would be better spent in doing grass there so people could use it. And it would be easier to maintain too. I think it would be cost effective to do it in a rolling thing. But other than that, I'm excited about it. I think it's going to be a great benefit to downtown, and we'll have a plaza per se for downtown. And I think everybody that's worked on this should be congratulated. And the effort that's going on the inside with the different venues going on there, I think you're doing a wonderful job. And for people that don't do anything, you seem to be getting things right. So,
Glenn, I like your comment about the granite. And just so that I can maybe look into your thought process on that, where were you thinking of with regards to granite? Are you talking about the...
Well, you can veneer the walls.
Yeah. You talking about the circle?
Right, yeah, yes. the circle and mm-hmm. the top of the circle.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So if you're gonna
That fountain is a quarried granite. I don't know if you can still get that quarried granite or...
Well, and you know...
Well, we can skin it.
You can skin it? Well, yeah, I don't know whether I don't know if you want to do it river rock or something, because most of the craftsman houses have river rock.
Well, and the reason why I guess I'm looking at it both not only aesthetically, but also, and I think somebody mentioned, I think you were talking about with the skate, problems with that. And granted,
if you had that quarried granite that's on the
absolutely,
there's nobody going to skateboard on that.
That's a deterrent. From that. So aesthetically it's pleasing. It becomes still a natural deterrent without having to put any features that actually, change the look of the circular thing. So, I mean, I like the idea.
Well, I think it ties it together. And here again, how many cities have built new libraries and built parks around them and everything, but this is the Monrovia way of doing things. It's much better because people put much more time in it. I think officially what happens, took me a long time to figure it out since I came to Monrovia, but the real difference what happens in Monrovia is what we do in Monrovia we do with passion, and the passion shows. And This is wonderful. I mean, the first plan I saw with the rectangle water feature, I thought, no, that's not it. That doesn't work. But this works. Like I said, you all should be congratulated. But just consider those things.
Thank you so much.
Thanks, Glenn.
And thanks for being here.
Sorry to keep you up so late.
No, that's all right. It's not coming to us, so I have to come to your arena.
Thank you again.
You guys put up with a lot more than we have to, thank God.
No comment. I'd like to, this time, take about a 5 to 10 minute break. We'll come back at 10 minutes to 10 and give us a chance to check out these materials. Thank you.
So you know how he's talking about...